Folks, welcome back to this Bible study. We're going to try to get all done in 1 hour if at all possible. It's a very somber lesson, a very important lesson. It's entitled Carnal-Minded Christians or Deceived Lost. What I mean by that is it's simply this. Yes, there are carnal-minded Christians who are not walking righteously before Christ. Maybe they're newborn. We'll discuss more in detail what carnal-minded Christians are. But many people are carnal-minded who think they're Christians and they're not. They've never been saved. They've been redeemed. They've been born again. Now, this is important. And I had some experience now pastoring for a long time and getting to talk to thousands of people. I never thought I'd be able to say that one day, but I've talked to thousands of people. And I've seen so many of them tormented and aggravated and frustrated and discouraged in their walk as a Christian. Because they're still under bondage to things that they can't unload. The question, I guess, is why do we have and live as believers with hatred or anger or bitterness or lust or strife or envy and vengeance in our heart? Why do we live like that? Why are we in bondage to these things? There's no peace in any of these things. There's no joy in any of these things, is there?
No.
These all have torment. A child of the living God shouldn't be under constant torment, should he, Bob?
No.
These and many other ailments, I guess you'd call them in this world today, a Christian should not have to live under and should not have their lives at all, basically. Quite honestly, they shouldn't have their lives at all. Do we from time to time? Yes. But we must not allow them to take root. The Bible talks in Hebrew about the root of bitterness springing up, doesn't it? The root of bitterness springing up. But most of the time, and I'm going to say this right out loud, as clear as I can, we have brought these devils on ourselves. We brought them ourselves. Of torment, and we always are to blame when we allow them to stay in this way, we're doing ourselves or not. But most of the time, things that we are do that, or we know are wrong, or do stupid things, bring these things upon us, and we live with them because we're mad because it happened. And we ought to be that way. And no one has to stay with these. No one. Yes, we are in a spiritual battle. We all know that, right? This is spiritual warfare. Now, I don't know how to get this across. I'm just learning a lot of this myself. But this is spiritual warfare against mighty forces, obviously. How many of y'all are all stuff say that Satan is a mighty opponent in his evil ways?
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
And can he afflict Christians?
He does all the time.
Oh sure.
But we are by faith, and this is what the scriptures tell us, we'll find that in a minute, but by faith and a sincere desire, we can overcome these forces of evil. All these devils that torment us and bitterness and anger and hatred, we do not have to live under them. My question is, I'm asking sincerely, why won't we be healed? If Christ is a great physician, he says he is, right?
Yes.
And did he not say, I give you powers over all these things?
Yes.
Then why do we live under their control? Why?
We've given place to one degree or another to Satan.
We have.
Yes.
And is that an excuse or a reason why we can't conquer? No, we don't want to. Now this is hard. But no Christian has to live under these conditions. If we continue, we all get there once in a while. We fall into it, and I know I have before. But if we stay there, it's our own choosing. Amen.
That's right.
But you know, Paul wrote in Hebrews chapter 5, I'll read verse 2 there. Paul wrote something in Hebrews chapter 5 that should really get our eyes on something. Yes, there are carnal-minded Christians. I'm going to show you this in a second, what I'm talking about. But in Hebrews chapter 5, Paul asked this question to people who were Hebrews. Now, why is that important? Why did I say they were Hebrews? What should the Hebrews have known before the Gentiles did?
They should have known the Savior.
They should know the Scripture, shouldn't they?
Right.
They should already know these things. And Paul looked at them and said in verse 12, he said this, verse 12 says this, for when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which is the first principles of the oracles or the words of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. He was chastising them. You should already know these things. You've been taught these things. Why not teach this again? Well, my question is again and again and again, why must we keep going back to teach Christians to overcome these devils of bitterness and anger and spitefulness and lust and strife? Why do I keep going back there? Why can't we get through this place and outgrow those things and walk as victors in Christ? Either Christ lied, or we can do all things through Him who strengthens us. We are more than conquerors in Christ. Why, if we know it's in the Bible, don't we live that way?
Choice. Yeah, we choose to.
Why would we choose to live in torment, Phil? In bondage, why?
I have a number of reasons, right?
I mean, why do we take pleasure in being bitter? And have it among us all the time, in our fellowship, in our homes. Why? What does it gain us? What profit does it give us?
There's something in the flesh.
It is in the flesh.
It has to be.
But aren't we to overcome the flesh?
Right.
Any comments so far?
You know, in verse 12, he says, you should have grown beyond this by now.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, and here I am going back again as a pastor. I'm doing this, people that listen to the radio show call me all the time that I've talked to you before, and I'm saying this nicely and out of love, but why must I keep going back to the basic rudiments of this whole thing again? Why do we continue to live in this anguish and torment when we're victors in Christ? You know, I'm not going to say that I'm not concerned with what I see going on in this country. I get frustrated, don't you, Dick?
Oh, yes.
I get disgusted with what I see, but I'm not going to let this drag me down spiritually. A soldier who's drugged down can't do much of a fight, can he?
No.
We're to lay aside these things. Now listen, Paul said, I wrote this down, Hebrews chapter 9, I think, I'm looking up. Lay aside all the sins that so easily beset us. Bitterness, hatred, strife, lust are sins. Lay those things aside and run the race with patience. How do you do that if you keep hanging on to these weights? Is that a good point? That ain't a bad point, not for you, but the preacher is it? Not bad. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You
know, people react two ways to problems in life. Either depression or it stimulates them to overcome.
Yes.
That seems to be the only two.
Yes. I see chapter 3. It's actually chapter 4.
Oh.
This is... Could it be? Now, let me ask this question. I'm asking this because I don't really know sometimes. Maybe I do a little bit. But could it be that we get some kind of perverted pleasure from this?
Called masochism.
Yeah, I was going to just say that.
Seriously, yeah. Could it be? Mm-hmm. That we like feeling sorry for ourselves? How many of you ever had a pity party?
Mm-hmm.
Why is everybody always picking on me?
Mm-hmm.
You remember that old song, Charlie Brown?
Yeah.
Maybe that's what Christians like to do. They like to have pity parties. I don't know. But I, for one, don't like being tormented, Dick Paul. I want to enjoy my time with my family if I can. Enjoy my time. I know this sounds corny as all get out. I got to feed the cows in the morning, or even when, but mostly in the morning. I love the mornings. Morning is my favorite time of day. Mm-hmm. Get out and feed the cows in the morning, and the dog was with me. I dumped that feed in the trough, so they never started eating. And I watch him eating that, and I watch the dog down and help the calf, because the calf eats on the ground. He won't try to eat the big cows. Put it in the ground, eat it, and watch the dog eat with him. The dog's eating cattle feed, just to eat with him. Then they look at the calf's face, you know, the calf will jump around and play with him. And I'm just going to enjoy, look at the skies. Last few days have been really blue around here. This morning was great. It was really blue and beautiful. Mm-hmm. Look at praising our Father for our creation. And I don't want to be drugged down with this stuff. I want to enjoy what He has given me to enjoy.
Right.
And I want the joy of my salvation in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
Remember David said in Psalms, restore to me the joy of my salvation.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I don't want to lose that joy. I want it to be abundant. I want people to see in me that there's a joy. Now, I get angry. I get discouraged. I'm only a man. But I refuse to dwell in that. Any comments so far? I'm going to start preaching as long as I get done here today.
Good.
But this is absolutely essential. These things in the body of Christ should not even be mentioned among us as far as being part of us. 1 Corinthians chapter 4.3. Verse 1. And I, brethren, to not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal or worldly. Now notice, these are carnal-minded Christians, right?
Yeah.
He said, brethren. Now why did he say that? Even as unto babes in Christ. In Hebrews chapter 5, he's got saying, you should already go beyond this. Now he's talking to you. He said, I have fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither ye yet now are ye able. For ye are yet carnal. Was this bragging on them?
No.
No, he was admonishing them pretty strongly.
For whereas there is among you envyings, or jealousy, and strife, and divisions, are ye not carnal, walk as men? He's talking to the church.
Yeah.
Why is this among you as Christians? He said, there's strife among you. There's divisions among you. There's envy among you. This ought not to be in the body of Christ.
Amen.
But there is. I have pastored Dick for over 30 years, and I have seen churches fight of the most damnably stupid things. Personality conflicts. How many there has never had a personality conflict with their spouse? Never had a personality conflict ever. Again, with anybody. The point I'm trying to make is this. They're going to have personality conflicts. But why is that gender strife and bitterness among us? I see people between husbands and wives, too. They're just like two bulldogs. Constantly at each other.
Yeah,
I mean, biting into each other and devouring each other. Paul said if you bite and devour each other, you destroy each other. You consume each other. Why do we do that? And the world's watching us, Nick, and wondering, hey, they're Christian. Look at them. Phil, who got, why are we that stupid? It ain't necessary. Matthew chapter 7. I was up in Wisconsin doing the funeral for Joan, reading out of the Bible. I'm going to prove to y'all that Paul was from the South. First time he said y'all.
Right.
And he said reckon.
Y'all reckon.
You reckon. That's what he said.
He's right.
Yeah. So, you know, I said, and I proved he's from the South. So I said, what's that? Let's go on now. But anyway, Matthew chapter 7. Now, this is the question I must ask. We know that Paul just said there are carnal-minded Christians. But the Bible says to be carnal-minded is an enemy with God. Right? It's an enemy of God. It cannot mesh. And eventually, if we don't see a change in the fruit of these people, there's something wrong inside. Is that not true?
Yeah.
The Bible says if you have the spiritual, you don't walk in the flesh, right?
Right.
You cannot serve two masters, can you?
No.
So if we do not see a change in fruit, Lynn, there's something wrong. The wrong part's in charge. Either the flesh or the spirit. It's your choice. I cannot make anyone change. But if they sincerely want freedom and liberty in Christ, don't come to me for answers. I give it to them, they don't want to hear it. It's like when the doctor get well and gives you medicine, you won't take it. Do you really want to get well? The medicine may be bitter. Bible says this.
Boy, no medicine doesn't have to taste good, it just has to work.
That's exactly right. I got crystal plaque in downtown Tennessee last time. They got a plaque for him in front of the desk. Put on your big girl panties and deal with it. And deal with it. That for crystal.
Suck it up,
yeah, suck it up. So what I'm saying is, if we're in this shape, let's quit whining about it. Let's fix it.
Amen.
The Christ of this in Matthew chapter 7. Listen, verse 20. Talking about good and evil, Christian, non-Christian. Verse 20. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. If their fruit is of the flesh, and it's always of the flesh, and it's always evil, then you can know that they're not walking in Christ. Hey, I figured that by myself. Not everyone that said to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter in the kingdom of heaven. So are they carnal-minded Christians or deceived lost? Now listen, these people call him Lord. What I said?
Yeah.
But he that doeth the will of my Father. Was the will of the Father to walk in strife and bitterness, hatefulness, and lust and anger? Is that the Father? No, it isn't. But those who will follow will enter in heaven. But they'll come and say, many will say by that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name and cast out devils and all that? That doesn't impress him a bit. Unless you're born again and following his will, you ain't going to make it to glory. You want to say that well?
Yeah, most Christian churches strongly preach salvation. Accept the Lord into your life as your Lord of your life. But they de-emphasize the next step, which is growth.
Yes.
And that's what Paul's talking about here. The growth that hasn't occurred. They accept it, and they think that's all there is to it. And most churches, that's all they teach, too, but...
Well, I know that. Every week is salvation, salvation, and salvation.
Right.
God be saved. God be saved. Hallelujah, I've been born again. What should I do now? I'm getting tired of milk. Give me something more solid. Give me a piece of bread.
That's called sanctification.
Exactly.
Growing
right.
Set apart.
Is it any wonder that the churches are so weak and anemic? I did a program Thursday night. I don't remember the exact thing he said, but it was kind of open line. I discussed Joan Beyond Street and some other things, and made a comment that most pastors today are, I can't remember what to say exactly, are well-paid 501c3 whores. And they don't want to rock the boat. I can't remember the exact words. The preacher from up in Ohio named Victor called in. He said, I want to call in and commend you for what you just said. He said, I haven't heard that said. I've never heard that said. You know, I mean, he was just shocked. I was saying on the radio that these pastors are well-paid whores. Well, if they're not going to preach the entire word of God, they're deceiving the people, and the people are dying, spiritually dying. And they think they're walking in faith, but they're weak and anemic and don't know it because they have anything besides milk. I think that's all there is.
Well, there is no way to stay at a certain level. You either progress or you regress.
Mm-hmm.
So to try to keep someone at that beginning level, eventually they're just going to, they're going to die. Yeah. Go backwards.
Yeah.
A weak church, because weakness has come by lack of faith. And faith only comes by what?
Hearing the word.
If they're not taught the word, then how are they going to grow in faith?
If you're weak, you're meek.
That's exactly right. And I will do teaching sometime soon on creation and proving beyond a shadow of a doubt that there is a creator. This isn't evolution. I mean, it can be proven. Now, will the world accept it? Of course not. It'll rock their boat. But I want to show you, I'm not a physics teacher, but I've got a book there right now about the simple cell, they call it.
Mm-hmm.
And all the intricacy of the cell. The DNA alone proves God to be a creator. It's amazing. But how we, and how the Bible, the word itself is divided all into sevens. All the Bible is divided into the numerals, divided and multiplied in numbers of seven. Why would the Almighty use seven to be a principle by that? What's the perfect number?
Seven is his number.
Yes.
The number of Yahweh.
Yes. The Bible was divided into the sevens in the original language, Hebrew and Greek.
Yeah.
It's amazing. But the more I study the scriptures, the greater my faith becomes. And if I don't study the scriptures, then I'll get weak myself. Don't admire me for my boldness and faith. It isn't me. It's the word in me.
It's power in the word.
It is. There is power in the word. Galatians chapter 5, the verses we studied many times before that we must go through again, because I'm seeing the conflicts come back again. And it ought not to be so in the body of Christ. We should not grow in this. At least some of us should have. The new listeners, I don't expect you to be above this. But many people I work with for years are still fighting the same battles over and over again. Why have they got confidence in these things? Because they have not wanted to. We're going to look at some things here. I'm going to read the definition right out of concordance. I don't like to give my definitions. I can be off. I'm going to concentrate on a few of the fruit of the flesh. A few of them. I'm not going to be able to cover them all, but a few of them. Now, I just wonder, when we read these things, now, let me ask these questions seriously. Are you not all guilty of reading this book and skimming through it and thinking that doesn't cover me? That's not me. I don't have any problems. That's the guy behind me. It's called Pitchfork Religion. Stick it behind me. The guy behind it is the same thing as the guy behind him. Christian, nobody's God. every word of this book applies to me and you.
Yes.
We said, search ourselves according to the standard.
Yes.
Search yourselves. And every time I do, I find myself lacking. But I praise him for his grace that he showed me that so I could walk closer to him. If you want to be more like him, why not take on his character? Amen. Any comments? Y'all have been very quiet today.
That's why he gave us this.
Sure it is.
To search and find out.
This is not just be a tabletop decorator.
Oh, by the way, at the Meet Your Candidate, mm-hmm. I told him the history about why people stood. He loved that. That they stood for the Bible, not the man.
Mm.
And that's what we've done. We've kicked the Bible out of everything. We've kicked God's word out of everything.
So man becomes his own God.
And so man's become God. No wonder that judge thinks he's God.
We made him.
In verse 18 of Galatians chapter 5. Now listen very carefully. I'm going to read down through there. So if you be led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Let me make a point here. We're going to look down through here. What law brings forth because of our evil is sin. Law was needed to show us our sins. That means that we still break the law. By the grace of God, we quit breaking the law because of the law we live in sin. This is so simple. This is 1, 2, 3, A, B, C. Mm-hmm. This is not in depth. This is milk study. If you don't drink the milk, you're not going to get on meat. Now the works of the flesh are manifest. What's the word manifest mean?
Shown.
Brought forth. Everything in your life will bring forth something. Everything you do, every attitude you have will eventually come out in who you are, what you say, and how you live. Everything you believe will eventually come out. Which are these? Adultery. Adultery, I'm not getting all these, what adultery is, but adultery day is going to be no big deal. Neither is fornication. Matter of fact, you just got to watch the video at a Lutheran school telling you fornication just fine. Just put a hat on the door so nobody bother you. Am I telling the truth on that? Just watch it. Uncleanness. Now, I want to look at that word uncleanness and see what it can mean. This is a fruit of the flesh. It works of the flesh. This is what it says. Now, that's what uncleanness is. It's number 167 in the concordance. It means impurity. Physical or moral. Impurity. Physical or moral. So what we have to do as believers then is look into ourselves from this scripture and this standard and see which part of us is being impure. What are we doing that could be, could this be brought to us in some way we haven't looked at before? If we want to get over the hurts and the anger and the strife and bitterness, perhaps this is part of our problem. Maybe we're living in one of these states of mind where we're living these things, we don't even know it, or we do know it, don't want to get rid of it. But if you want to get rid of that torment, you got to get rid of the one that's caused this, the sin that's causing it. Is that true?
And the standards for clean and unclean were still in existence in the New Testament and weren't done
apparently
away
so.
With?
Apparently so.
Huh.
Lasciviousness, which is sensuality. I'm not going to get through all these. I'm going to get through a few of them. Idolatry. Witchcraft. Now, I looked this up, but I didn't put it in. I just have to share it with you. You know what witchcraft is, this word right here? We always think about witchcraft, you know, the pointed hats and the spells, and that it is. But it's pharmakia. Pharmakia is where we get the word pharmacy from. It also says druggist, poisoner.
Wow.
Now, this is your concordance, look for yourself. Now, I'm not talking about people taking medicine because they're sick. I'm talking about people who do this for getting high or...
Escape.
Escape.
Control.
Mm-hmm. It's poisonous. It's pharmacy. It's druggist. The word druggist, the root word is drug. Okay? So people do illegal drugs. Well, you can do illegal drugs with awful drugs. You can get hooked on too. So be careful with this. Witchcraft is depending on drugs to keep your mental state of mind in the right place, keep you calm enough to live in society. We shouldn't need that. We have the Holy Ghost.
What's the classical picture of a witch around a cauldron?
Sure, exactly.
Boiling, eye of a toad, hair of a bat, or, you know.
Yeah.
And brewing it up, just like a classical pharmacist did in his back lab when he made medicine for people. Now we have big companies do it, like Klein and that.
Anytime you have to use medicine, pharmakia, to keep yourself in a mental high, a spiritual high even, or any kind of high, there's something wrong with you, spiritually. If the Holy Ghost is in you, why do you need the presence of a holy God through His Spirit in you and add something to it to keep you going? Is He so weak He can't help you do it? Come on, folks, this is serious stuff.
That's right.
No.
Why do we need alcohol to get through the day?
You're a weak-minded person.
You are. You're weak in Christ, so you're still on meat, you're still on milk. Now, if you're truly born again, you're going to want to get over that, aren't you?
Yeah.
Once you see the truth, you're going to want to get out of that mess. Why do you need booze to be happy, to get drunk? Why do you want booze in the house at all? What for?
Or even to forget.
Yeah, even to forget. Why? Other than a medicine purposes, why would you want it? If you need booze to get through the day, you're hooked on it. That is sin. Booze is a drug.
Yep. How about chocolate?
Sure, it can be. I know people
that have to have that box of chocolate there.
Every day. I mean, anything controls you is an idol.
Yeah.
I watch news tonight. Somebody on the news is drinking 30 cans of Coke a day.
Oh, yeah.
To get through the day.
That's even your morning cup of coffee. My sakes alive.
We don't do it for excess. But 30 cups a day is quite excessive.
Yeah, it's quite excessive. Yeah.
Needs it to get through the day. No
caffeine highs from it.
But I'm saying this out of love because I went through this. I'm still going through this. I have to fight these things every day. I'm in the world. I'm not of the world, but I'm in this world. Everything, everywhere I look around me, it's all around me, isn't it?
Yeah. It's around my world.
The next word is hatred. I'm going to read what that means. Number 2189 in the concordance. And there's a lot more besides this. I'm going to read this one. Hostility is hatred.
We just lost the recording.
Okay, I saw something flash.
Yeah. The power.
Best stop time.
Yeah, let me.
What, did you blow a fuse?
No.
Actually, the recorder is still going on. Shut the TV on.
Pretty windy there for a bit.
Yeah.
You had to hear that door rattling over here. Was that your head rattling?
That was the thing.
Oh, that thing on top of there. Okay.
Yeah, it's still running.
My head don't rattle anymore.
I'm still running up it. Hatred is hostility. Did you ever picture in mind? How many of you ever seen a hostile person?
I've been hostile myself.
Yes. Did you know that was hatred? Did you picture
right,
that?
I was out of control.
You know, I mean, hostility should not be a common thing for a Christian, should it? I can become hostile in an easy situation where it's justified. But to have it every day is a common way of living, a common attitude, that's hatred.
Yeah.
Always be hostile means to always be willing to fight and pick fights and never get along. That's hostility. And I see that between husband and wives continually. I see between church members. Always gossiping and bickering back and forth behind each other's back. And I've heard so much that in my lifetime I want to puke.
A brother so-and-so said this to me. Did you see what sister so-and-so wore to church and know what she done?
I mean, it's on.
She wore a hat in church.
That's not a sin. I've had it to me. She wore a hat in church. It's fine if they wear a hat in church. Not a man, but this lady can. So I've seen these things, and I think, what is wrong with these people? Are they just looking for fights? They're hostile.
Well, they're conditioned by the one-eyed monster. I mean, these soap operas.
Oh, yeah.
Are nothing but people fighting with each other in conflict constantly.
And variance is next, which is discord. Variance, discord. Discord among the brethren ought not be there. How can a body have discord among itself and function right? If my body just had discord, if my feet quit communicating with my mind, I would be able to walk with it.
No.
Is that not true? Mm. Well, a body that's full of discord is a dysfunctional body. Hit church pretty hard, don't it?
Yeah.
Go a little further here. Emulations. I want to cover that one. Emulations. This is that concordance again. It is, what did I find here again? Oh, I want to get back to variance. Variance very quickly. Variance is number 2054. Contention, debate, and strife. contention between brothers and sisters, husbands and wives, fathers and parents and children, or debate and strife, or variance, or discord. That ought not to be in us. Personally, ourselves, not be in that kind of situation, nor should be among our families, nor the church family. Go ahead, Bob.
Debate, I can see, you know, where that is, because in any debate, I took debating class when I was in high school, you had a winner and a loser.
Mm-hmm.
And within the church body, there shouldn't be losers.
Yeah.
We should all be winners.
It should be discussion, not debate.
Discussion, exactly.
Exactly. Yeah. Emulations is this. It's number 2205, 04, and 06. Emulations is jealousy.
Ooh.
Envy. Covetousness. Emulations. Why would there be jealousy in the body of Christ? Any means in the body of Christ? Why, if these things bring torment, if they cause me bitter and always upset with their husbands or wives or children or church family, if these things cause these things, why do we allow them to be in us? If we want to overcome this hatred and anger and bitterness and torment, why do we allow these things to control us? These are the works of the flesh, not of the Holy Spirit. Does the Holy Spirit become so weak and timid that he can't help us overcome these things?
No.
Do we hang on to him because we like him? Maybe so. Maybe that perverted. That's almost like that you saw in that video,
like
bondage. Yeah, like bondage. Be whipped by whip to mm-hmm. enjoy sex. Mm-hmm. That's perverted. That's devilish. Mm-hmm. That's not the devil.
Right. Of course.
So is this, if you do these things, continue in them, then you enjoy them, you're perverted. You may not be saved. You might want to check that. If you enjoy living in sin, I doubt that you've been converted. The Bible tells me if you convert, you become a new creature. And it says you seek the things above, not things on earth. Is that true? Colossians chapter 3
right.
says that.
Right.
So if you live and enjoy it, I doubt that you've been born again. Is that a fair statement?
That's fair.
Let's look at, let's see, go a little further here. Where are we at? Murders, drunken, Avians. Oh, man. Okay, I got a place here. Wrath. All right, let's take a look at wrath. Number 2372 in the concordance. Fierceness, indignation, fierceness. Why would a Christian want to be fierce? What's it mean to be fierce?
Aggressive. I mean, these cars that have passing and have that loud muffler specifically to make noise, and they pass you, cut you off, and there's a sign in the window that says, "Fear this!"
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Well, if you had a ferocious dog, what's it mean ferocious? What do you want to do?
It just has one thing in mind, and that's destruction.
He wants to bite somebody, right?
Yeah.
He wants to attack somebody. So if this wrath's in you, then you will attack people. Gossip about him. Destroy him. That's not right for a Christian, is it?
No.
Isn't this amazing how simple it is when you think about it? Now, will that make you discontented if you're fierce? Make you hateful to live with?
Nobody want to be around you.
Why would we let this dwell in our lives? Why would a husband or a wife, I'm just using a husband wife's example, that's how I'd be married. Why would a wife want to constantly tell her husband? They're always telling him down, belittling. In front of everybody. Why would you want to do that? Or vice versa. Why would you want to do that? Why would you say you love that person and want to destroy him? That's a good question, isn't it?
Yes, good question.
Possibly because they're in competition for the same position within the household.
Authority builds them up and puts you down.
Exactly. Next one, strife. 25:2 in the concordance. It is, again, contention. Strife is contention. Constant bickering back and forth and contention in your lives. Will constant contention cause stress in your life?
Mm-hmm.
Will it cause a lack of peace in your life?
Sure.
Will it cause maybe even hatred, after a while, hatefulness in your life? And resentment in your life?
It can make a mild-mannered dog bite.
Absolutely it can. Absolutely. Next one, let's go further. Here we have envies. I'm sorry. We have seditions in next. Seditions is 1370. Dissension and disunion. Seditions are are dissension and disunion. When a body becomes disunified, what happens to the body?
It dies.
It has to. How can a body live without its parts? Disunion. Sedition means dissension and disunion. If a married couple has had disunion, are they happily married?
No.
If a church has it in them, are they happy fellowship?
No.
These are works of the flesh. Why do we allow them on us? And going down through there, you'll find others too: heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the time past. Now listen to me. I didn't write this. That they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Barry should tear that and throw it away. That ain't first day, is it?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Fourth day.
You mean if we're living with angerness and bitterness and envy and vengeance in us and strife and lust, we're not going to go to heaven? What did Paul say?
Definitely.
Now, Phil, what should I do with that? I don't like it either, because that means I have to get myself in line, too.
Right.
But what do I do with it? Do I just ignore it and hope it goes away?
Those are the outward signs.
They are. That's it. Yes. And if it's outward, guess what it is on the inside? If you had a cancer growing here and you finally talked about it in your flesh, can you imagine what it looks like on the inside? It's like an iceberg. You see the tip of the iceberg.
Right.
But what's underneath that? That's good teaching, folks. It's really serious. If we have that in our lives and we do not get rid of it, Paul said, you're not going to get in the kingdom of God.
We're going to purge it.
But why would we, why don't we want to? That's my question, is why don't we want to? Should that not make us fear a little bit? Let's go real quick. I'm going to finish up with the...
We're all under demon influence. Tries to get us to accept these things constantly, day in and day out. And we have to fight that.
And verse 22 says this. Remember Christ said in Matthew 7, you know by the fruits?
Right.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Charity, the word there is actually, charity means all this combined. It's the agape love.
Right.
For each other, love. Joy. Yeah, situations and circumstances may take away some of your happiness, but the joy of Christ, the Bible says, cannot be touched. That's what it says. And peace. If you're constant turmoil with yourself and others, you're not living in peace. Long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. So that must mean that the ones up front in the flesh are against the law, but these aren't. There's no law against the fruit of the Spirit, but there is against the works of the flesh.
Right.
And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. Would that mean the works are going away too then? If you kill it, how does it keep on producing works? Folks, come on, help me with this. This is easy. Mm-hmm. Isn't it? If you crucify the flesh, why is it still in control? There's crucified the flesh with the affections or passions and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. I don't know if that's really complicated or what, but I thought it was pretty easy.
That's why Christians aren't under those laws against those
exactly.
Things.
We're not because controlled
they got
by those.
Rid of them.
They were not controlled by those. In 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm sitting right here today among... I've had some very good folks. Not many of us here today. Never are, really. Be a few more tomorrow. Maybe someone's real, but not going to be here among us. But I look at people out here that are working hard to do what's right. Phil Hudlock, for example, here is running for office in West Virginia. Has run his tail off just trying to make a point to some people. His hands to the women are worse than David against Goliath. That's a fact.
Sure.
But he's out there trying. He's not griping and moaning about it. He just only has to do. Trying to stand for what's right and truth. What was it? We got to hurry to it. But what was it that kept the Israelites out of the promised land?
Disbelief.
What was the devil all the time? What was the devil all the time? He called disbelief. What was the devil all the time?
Moaning
and groaning and mumbling.
Peeing and moaning.
Exactly. That's what they were doing. And it kept them out of the kingdom of God, so to speak. Paul just said the same thing, didn't he?
Yeah.
Now, see, the Old Testament and New Testament kind of go together. In 1 Peter chapter 1, let's see what the Bible says about things this here. Verse 8. Whom having not seen, ye love, talking about Christ, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Does that sound like a chore to you? Is it a drive to serve Christ? Is it hard? Is it frustrating? I mean, does that sound like it should be? Does that sound like something that you just don't want to do, serve Christ?
It says rejoice.
Yes, it's joy, unspeakable joy and full of glory. So if you're always miserable, there's something wrong with you. Comments? I'm hurrying now.
That's true.
Philippians chapter 4. We do have miserable days sometimes. But if you're always miserable, there's something wrong. That joy unspeakable and full of glory is a gift to you as a believer. You know what makes it really, really a joy is knowing that no matter what happens, if we're trying to serve our Father, whether we, in our minds, think we win or lose, we win anyway. If we're doing our best to do what's right, if they take a gun and... The world say, he lost. No, he didn't. He just won. He just won. You just helped him get over the finish line. True? Mm-hmm. Joan Vianne crossed the finish line before we did. She didn't lose. Mm-mm. Cancer may have taken her life, but it didn't touch her spirit and soul.
No, it didn't.
May have took her body, but she's going to get a brand new one.
So I told a nurse at Charleston Area Medical Center when I had my heart attack. She's helping him. He's laughing and smiling. He's having a heart attack. I said, lady, I said, I can't lose. She said, can't lose. You could die. I said, look. I said, I came up here to get fixed. If you fix me, I win. If I die, I'm right with my Lord and Savior. I still win. I said, I can't lose.
You can't lose.
She said, looked at me, says, amazing. And I had to add the word. I said, Grace.
Her name was Grace.
Amazing Grace.
And look, Philippians chapter 4. You know, I never had to go through this. I really can't speak of what happened to me in a situation where I lost my house, maybe. Or I was having a hard time putting food on the table. Yeah, I had money really tight, but I never dealt with how food was. Found some way to have a garden or somehow shoot the deer, whatever. We always kept food on the table, Jimmy Dick.
Yep.
Sometimes there's little scarce money to buy extras with, maybe, but we always had a basic staple food.
Amen.
So I've never had to do with those things, really. What would happen to me spiritually if I did? I do not know yet. Like if I could have it okay and go on. Because it would be my Father's will, obviously. So I'm not belittling anybody who gets frustrated and discouraged sometimes. We all have done that. But there's no point in letting Satan win a victory in us to destroy our peace and joy with our Savior. There isn't. There just isn't. Philippians chapter 4, verse 7 says this. And the peace of the world, somebody correct me. Philippians chapter 4, verse 7. And the peace of Social Security check.
And the peace of God.
And the peace of what?
God.
Of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. That's a flat statement. And the peace of God. If you don't have a peace in your heart, I'm not saying everything is always hunky-dory and circumstances aren't bad. Maybe you're broke. Maybe you can't do this. But I'm not saying those things don't happen. But the peace of God is untouchable by the world. If you don't have that peace, there's something wrong in you that you have not let Christ take care of yet. Why would you live in torment, brothers and sisters? Why allow that? I watched Joan's husband, Rod. They married 33 years. I think they probably liked each other a little bit, don't you?
Yeah.
But I watched him rejoice at Joan's going home, not because he didn't miss her. Oh, that's obviously an understatement. But he didn't sit there and be moaning, why me, Lord? Why did you take my wife? And he said, praise my Father, she's at home at rest. Mm-hmm. And I'll see her again one day. That was his attitude. That's a Christian attitude. Right. Didn't mean he isn't hurting. You're going to go home with an empty house. That's going to hurt.
First time I attended a funeral, funeral of a real Christian man. After the funeral, it was at their home. My children wanted to go with. I said, it's not going to be a happy place. Why was I wrong? They were telling stories about the old boy and reminiscing.
We are looking for something better.
Sure, mm-hmm. They knew.
That graveyard's not the end for us, Dick.
That's the beginning.
That's our new, that's
they
where
got
we
got an
get
ahead
out
of
this
you.
Womb, this tomb, and go to meet our
you
father.
You got an attorney ahead of
exactly.
You.
It's commencement.
It is. Ephesians chapter 5.
That's graduation.
Right out of time. How many enjoyed this so far?
Oh, yeah.
I want everyone to be set free. And oh, I have problems. Next spring, Lord, I know we're going to have every cost to me and do a complete, for all of us, I want to first get it. I want him to pray for me about any devil that may torment me. I want him out of me. I want him away from me.
Absolutely.
I want him out of me. So I want to be prayed for. I'm sure I got some there about me all the time. And I know it from time to time because I'm only a man. He says that every Christian has 36 of them that torment him and aggravate him. But we don't have to stay down with these things. We have the power to overcome them in Christ. Ephesians chapter 5. Be ye therefore, Paul, and me as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. We're to walk in love or contention or hatred.
Love.
Love. But fornication and all uncleanness, I just read it to you as a work of the flesh. Or covetous, let it not once be named among you and become a saint. It's not becoming for a saint to have these problems. It's not becoming to a young lady to dress like a whore, is it?
No.
Shouldn't be for a Christian either, should it? Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. That's the same thing you said in Galatians chapter 5. The same thing. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. This is serious stuff. Let no man deceive you with vain words. Because of these things cometh the wrath of God. Pay attention. Upon the children of disobedience. The children of God can lose their inheritance. He just said so. The children disobey will lose the right to the kingdom of God.
Disobey what? The law?
Not the word of God.
The word of God, yes.
Be not ye therefore partakers with them. In other words, do not commiserate with them.
Commiserate.
Yeah. we got it.
Did you make that up?
Well, that's old word. I heard for a while.
Yeah.
1 John chapter 3. Phil, show the clock down just a little bit. We just slow it down just a little bit. I just did.
Two seconds.
All right. Well, I'm going to do the whole week here then. 1 John chapter 3. Now listen to me. There's one, I'll just tell you, the first fruit of the Spirit is the one that's lacking if any of the rest of them are not in place. It's love. That love, you can have peace. You can have joy. You can have long-suffering.
Right.
Love covers it all. Love is a fulfillment of the law. Right?
Yeah.
Love is a fulfillment of the law, right? Now listen. If you have bitterness and anger and strife and enmities and lust in your personal life and with your family, whatever, you're not walking in love. You're walking in the flesh. Why? Now if you enjoy walking in the flesh, more power to you. But please don't bring that disease among us. We don't want it. I don't want it in my life.
Right.
I'll minister to you if you want out of it. But if you don't want out of it, don't bring it among a healthy body. Is that good enough to say it that way?
It infects.
It does infect.
Yes.
1 John chapter 3, verse 14. We know, now listen, we know that we have passed from death unto life because we have contention with the brethren.
We love the brethren.
We know that we pass from death into life because we love the brethren. If the love isn't there, have you passed from death into life?
Not according to this.
He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. What do I do with that if I don't like it, Dick? Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him.
finished teaching on murder, too, four teachings.
I did.
Yeah.
Now, look at this, please. You mean if I'm using a family again, if I live in a family, if I hate my wife for no reason, just hate her because I don't like being around, I'm just that kind of person, or I'm always bitching at her, or griping at her, or nagging at her, or at strife with her, then the love of God is not in me. I do not have eternal life in me either. I think we need to examine ourselves sometimes, don't we?
Closely and daily.
Comments, Phil? No. Barry? Comments?
Yeah.
Comments, Lynn? Anybody did?
Mm-mm.
Chapter 4, same book. Verse 12. No man has seen God at any time. I haven't, have you? If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. If is a conditional word.
Yeah.
Please tell me this is making sense. You know that if we have unforgiveness in our hearts, we're in torment. Even if someone wronged you 40 years ago and never did tell you sorry, let that dwell in your soul, what's it going to do to you?
Eat it, like the cancer.
Yeah, turn the cancer on. Yeah. I'm not going to let that do it. I will not let that do that to me.
That's a choice, isn't it?
It is.
Yep.
Matthew 5. Boy, we've got to hurry. Matthew 5. Gosh, the time goes by so fast. Ain't fair. Matthew 5, 43 and 44. You have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate and thine enemy. I say to you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you, and persecute you. That doesn't mean that we take, we're doormats. That means we don't let this anger build up inside us and let them turn to hatred. We will love them in Christ and try our best to live peace among men. That doesn't mean that I let somebody come in and kill me and love them for it. Don't take this to the extreme. But it means I'll not let them control me by hatred. You follow what I'm saying? You understand? It's important. Say yes or no.
Get along with your neighbors much as life.
Exactly. Proverbs 15.
What's that despiteful use you in the Aramaic interlinear says those that lead you by force. That's interesting.
Yes, it is.
Day and age.
Proverbs 15. I want to hurry through these. Verse 1. A soft answer turneth away wrath.
Yes.
But grievous words stir up anger. Why would you want to bite me back if I hurt your feelings? Why not speak to me softly and love me, and I guarantee that'll heap coals of fire in my head.
Mm-hmm.
Is that not true?
Yes.
This works. I've done it many times. I really have.
Calm down the situation just by a nice word.
It does. Proverbs 16. Verse 2. All the ways of man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirits, or his motives, or his actions, or what, the way he lives. And one more verse, 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. One more verse. Verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are going into the world. Try the spirits. If that spirit leads you to anger and strife and vengeance, is that of God?
No.
No. Try the spirit. If we are angry and want vengeance, this is not of God.
Vengeance is his.
Justice is of God. Vengeance is not.
Amen.
There's a big difference.
There's a big difference. And then closing, we'll say this. And the sermon I did up at Jones' funeral, I made a comment. I'll make this comment here very quickly. On everyone's tombstone, including Jones, you'll find one thing in common. A date born and a date died. Is that true? On Jones, it was May 1949, October 2010. And one thing we have in common again, the only thing separate those two dates is a little dash. And in that dash is your whole life.
Mm-hmm.
Life has been a vapor. The legacy you leave behind contains that dash. The impact you made on people's lives, either negative or positive, are in that dash.
That's your legacy.
That's your legacy.
Yep.
That's a heritage that you leave your children, is that little dash. A dash is not very long, is it? Life's not very long, is it?
No.
We don't have a lot of time to let these powers over us control us, do we? Why do we want to waste one day, 1 hour, 1 minute, when Satan calls us to hurt others and be angry with others? Why do we do that? I know we're all guilty of it. I'm guilty too. But why do we do it? We don't have to, do we? Would you all rather leave each other today and with love for each other and a good meeting? Would you rather leave in strife and turmoil and go home and one of us die? Would you rather have a memory last time you saw your brother or sister that you give them a kiss on the cheek and tell them you loved them? Would you rather leave with the memory that I told them where to go? Because they did something to make me mad. That dice is very short, Dick.
Yeah, that when somewhere to go just shows your mental intellect.
It does. Folks, hope this lesson makes sense to you. Narrow-minded or deceived, lost. I will submit this to you that you can't live in these deceptions and call yourself Christians. The Lord of God says you're going to hell. That's what it says. I can deny it. I can tear it out. Fidelity isn't there. It doesn't change the truth, does it? See you next time.
I had a dream the other night that, well, I didn't understand. A figure walked in through the mist with a flintlock in his hand. His clothes were torn and dirty as he stood there by my bed. He took off his three-cornered hat, and speaking low to me, he said, "We fought a revolution to secure our liberty. We wrote the Constitution as a shield from tyranny. For future generations, this legacy we gave. In this, the land of the free and home of the brave. The freedoms we secured for you, we hoped you'd always keep. But tyrants labored endlessly while your parents were asleep. Your freedom's gone, your courage lost, you're no more than a slave. In this, the land of the free and home of the brave. You buy permits to travel and permits to own a gun, permits to start a business or to build a place for one. On land that you believe you own, you pay a yearly rent, although you have no voice in saying how the money's spent. Your children must attend a school that doesn't educate, and your Christian values can't be taught according to the state. You read about the current news in a regulated press, and you pay a tax you do not owe to please the IRS. Your money is no longer made of silver nor of gold. You trade your wealth for paper, so your life can be controlled. You pay for crimes that make our nation turn from God in shame. You've taken Satan's number. You've traded in your name. You've given government control to those who do you harm, so they could burn down churches and seize the family farm, and keep our country deep in debt, put men of God in jail, harass your fellow countrymen while corrupted courts prevail. Your public servants don't uphold the solemn oaths they've sworn. And your daughters visit doctors so their children won't be born. Your leaders send artillery and guns to foreign shores and send your sons to slaughter fighting other people's wars. Can you regain the freedoms for which we fought and died? Or don't you have the courage or the faith to stand with pride? And are there no more values for which you'll fight to save? Or do you wish your children to live in fear and be a slave? Oh, sons of the Republic, arise, take a stand. Defend the Constitution, the supreme law of the land. Preserve our great republic and each God-given right. And pray to God to keep the torch of freedom burning bright. As I awoke, he'd vanished in the mist from whence he came. His words were true. We are not free, but we have ourselves to blame. For even now, as tyrants trample each God-given right, we only watch and tremble, too afraid to stand and fight. If he stood by your bedside in a dream while you were asleep and wondered what remains of the freedoms he'd fought to keep, what would be your answer if he called out from the grave, "Is this still the land of the free and home of the brave?" God bless you, God bless this room.